Yo, what's up, everyone? I haven't been purposefully delaying the review of this sampler. It's just that it's one of those samplers that can give the impression that it doesn't have anything to it. The EPS Classic is almost like it's a person. He's quiet, he doesn't have too much to say, he's always dressed up like in a suit all the time. But what you don't know is that he's been to jail, and when he was in jail, he learned everything he could possibly know about criminal life. So he gets out now and he cleans his life up, but at any time he can go back to his criminal ways. You know, that's kind of like what the EPS is. You'll tend to overlook it for the 16 Plus and the ASR10 and the ASRX, but what you don't know about the EPS is it has this no holds barred interface. The Classic can sample at one of the highest sample rates of any InSonic sampler. On the input, it can sample up to 52 kilohertz, and that will give you something really sharp and clean and tight. Like it sounds really, really all together when you sample up at that high sample rate. And then it can go all the way down to 6.25 kilohertz and sound really muddy and just gross. All the while being 13-bit, which is odd in itself. Like, I don't think there's any other sampler out there that samples at 13-bit. And I know there's a reason why InSonic did that, but it's just really odd. Like, it's not a multiple of two at all. And of course, it doesn't have any effects or anything like that. And this is why it tends to get overlooked, because right after that came the 16 Plus, same interface, but with effects. So most people will go for the 16 Plus simply because it sounds like you're getting the same thing as the EBS, save for a higher bit rate and effects. It just seems like a better deal. But there is something to the Classic. It has this ability to make things sound just murky. You know, it's this kind of shady sampler. You can't really figure it out, and it makes you feel kind of uneasy when you're listening to it. It just feels like it has something up its sleeve. It's not warm, it's not really anything. It just has this kind of off-putting presence to it, and I think that's the best way I can describe it, and it's also the greatest quality of the EPS. Scary is another word to use. If you have a moment, pick yourself up a copy of Wu-Tang's first album and listen to that. There's a heavy amount of the EPS Classic on that. And the whole album just sounds strange. And I just remember when that album did drop, that was the exact feeling that I had. The album just sounded out of place. I didn't even like the album when it first came out, but it grew on you and you kind of fell into the vibe of what RZA was doing at the time. And this sampler, I believe, had a big part to play with the sound of that record. So here I have the rack version, which is, it's fairly rare. You see them pop up every now and then. I never even seen the rack version. I didn't know there was one. And when I learned that it did exist, that's the one I figured I wanted because I just never saw one. I thought it was really rare. And I would recommend if you're going to get an EPS, this would be the one to get just for the fact that it's not very common. Keyboard versions you can get all the time, anywhere, at almost any price, depending on the condition of it. The rack version comes with 8 outs and it does have a SCSI port on it, but the SCSI port is not compatible with zip drives or anything newer like that. If you have an older SyQuest drive or older drives that were in production around that time, they're more likely to work, and there is a list online of drives that do work with the Classic EPS. The keyboard version is expandable and overall is more versatile than the rack because it comes with a keyboard. Overall, I would say do not underestimate the versatility of this sampler. The fact that its sample rates are so high is intriguing enough to look into it. I know all the rage these days are in lo-fi and lower bit rates and that sort of thing. But one thing to understand is in those times when samplers with lower bit rates were available, we were all striving for better sound quality. It's not like everyone thought 12-bit and 8-bit was great. There was literally nothing available at a price point that the regular person could afford that provided 16-bit or 24-bit quality. So that is what we had. And that is what we used. But had something better come out, we would have used it. So when you see sampling rates that are this high on a sampler this old, that is the reason. In order to get an effective price point, 13 bits was a good choice. It was still 1 bit better than 12, which does make a lot of difference. But the sample rate is really what keeps a sample together, what makes it really real to your ear. When you drop to lower sample rates and you lose a lot of information, your ear picks it up, your ear picks up everything. And it sounds more chopped up and less real. And that's what you'll hear with this sampler. It has a way of tightening things up, and of course, it has no problem going down the lo-fi lane. All in all, I'd say the EPS Classic does really well with drum sounds like snares, pretty much snares. Any sample with a lot of information in the mid-range area, it does well with that. It's not really a bass monster, it's not really a sparkling high-end type of thing. It just gives this real mid-murky sound to it. I mean, that's the best, again, it's the best way that I could describe it. So those are my initial thoughts on the EPS Classic. Underrated? Yes. Ignored? Yes. Worth buying? Yes. It is all of those things. And I think in light of the rest of things that Insonic has produced, it will always be viewed that way. But to those who take the time to look into this, you'll definitely be rewarded. Thanks for watching. Follow me on Facebook. Buy my album, Passage to a Kebulon, and the Daydream Sound 1 at thedaydreamsound.com. Take care. Peace.